Dear students, in this particular lecture, we are going to start Unit 5 of Engineering Mechanics. So, the Unit 5 is Dynamics of Particles, and in this particular unit, we are going to discuss about both kinematics and kinetics of particles. So, first let us see about kinematics, and here in this particular lecture, we are going to particularly see about rectilinear motion of particles. The contents of what we are going to see in this lecture are introduction to dynamics, characteristics of dynamics. So here we are going to see some of the important definitions involved in kinematics, and also we are going to see about rectilinear motion. So rectilinear motion is nothing but the motion of a particle along a straight line. So here we have two cases, rectilinear motion with uniform acceleration and rectilinear motion with variable acceleration. And in rectilinear motion with uniform acceleration, we are going to see three different cases. So, where the particle is going to move in the horizontal direction. And the second case is a particle which is moving vertically downwards. And the third case is a particle which is having vertically upward motion. Now, we'll see what is meant by dynamics. So, we have seen about this in the first class of our engineering mechanics. So, dynamics is nothing but a branch of mechanics which deals with study of forces and their effects on a moving body. So, this is dynamics, and we have two different branches of dynamics. One is kinematics, another one is kinetics. So, kinematics is nothing but the study of motion of a body without considering the forces which cause the motion. So, here in the analysis of problems, we don't consider the forces which cause the motion. So, simply we are going to study the relationship between displacement, velocity, acceleration and time of a given motion. So, here the forces which causes the motion are not considered in the system. Whereas in the case of kinetics, so it deals with study of motion of a moving body by considering the forces which cause the motion. So, here we are going to see the relationship between the mass of the body and the motion of the body. So, that is the difference between kinematics and kinetics. So, in this particular unit 5, we are going to discuss about both kinematics as well as kinetics. And here in this particular lecture, we are going to focus on kinematics and particularly the rectilinear motion of particles. And coming to the types of motion, so we have two types of motion in general. So, one is rectilinear motion, another one is curvilinear motion. So, rectilinear motion, here the particle is going to move along a straight line. So, examples, we can see a car moving on a straight road, or a body which is projected vertically upward, or a body falling vertically downward. So, these are the examples of rectilinear motion, and here the particle is going to move only along a straight line. Whereas in the case of curvilinear motion, the particle is not going to move along a straight line. Instead, it is going to take a curved path. So, that is called as curvilinear motion. And now we'll see some of the important definitions in kinematics. So the first simple definition is displacement. So as you know, when a particle is subjected to any force, so there will be change in position of a body. So this change in position will occur in any specific direction. So this change in position of a body, we call it as displacement. Normally the displacement is indicated by S. And coming to velocity, so as we all know, the rate of change of displacement is called as velocity. So, we can write velocity v is equal to ds by dt. And when a particle is in motion, so we have the acceleration also. So, this acceleration is denoted as a. So, we can define the acceleration as rate of change of velocity. So, in equation form, we can say a is equal to dv by dt. And in velocity, we can categorize velocity into three different types. One is uniform velocity, another one is variable velocity, and the third one is instantaneous velocity. So, in the case of uniform velocity, the particle is going to cover equal distances in equal intervals of time. For example, if a particle travels a distance of 1 meter in 10 seconds, so in the next 10 seconds also, it is going to travel 1 meter. So if it travels equal distances in equal intervals of time, then that particular velocity is called as uniform velocity. On the other hand, when a particle covers unequal distances in a particular interval of time, that velocity is called as variable velocity, or sometimes it is also called as non-uniform velocity. Whereas instantaneous velocity is nothing but the velocity which is measured at any instant of its motion. So that is called as instantaneous velocity. And similarly, the acceleration also can be classified into the following types. One is uniform acceleration, another one is variable acceleration. So uniform acceleration is nothing but you have equal changes in velocity in equal intervals of time. Suppose if you have unequal changes in velocity in equal intervals of time, then that acceleration is called as variable acceleration, also called as non-uniform acceleration. And based on the direction or based on the rate of change of velocity, the acceleration can be further classified as positive acceleration as well as negative acceleration. Suppose if the rate of change of velocity is positive, then it is called as positive acceleration. And if the rate of change of velocity is negative, then it is called as retardation or deceleration. So similar to instantaneous velocity, we can also measure the acceleration of a particle at any instant of time. So that particular acceleration, we call it as instantaneous acceleration. Now first let us see about the rectilinear motion with uniform acceleration. So for that, let us consider a particle which is moving with an initial velocity of u and a final velocity of v. So this t is nothing but the time taken by the body to change its velocity from u to v. And s is the distance traveled by the body in meters. A is the acceleration of the body in meter per second square. So we know well about the equations of motion. So these equations are well known to us. So you know that the final velocity or v is equal to u plus at, and also the distance traveled can be written as s is equal to ut plus half at square. Also the final velocity v can be written as v square is equal to u square plus 2as. So these three equations are called as equations of motion. So here u is the initial velocity, v is the final velocity, a is the acceleration, t is the time taken by the body for the velocity to change from u to v, and s is the distance traveled by the body. And these three equations we are going to use for solving the problems of rectilinear motion with uniform acceleration. And in these equations, suppose if your body starts from rest, then the initial velocity will be 0 and you have to substitute u is equal to 0. And suppose if the particle or body comes to rest, then your final velocity will be 0. In that case, you have to substitute v is equal to 0. And in the case of a negative acceleration or retardation, so we have to substitute a as minus a, because in the case of negative acceleration, the particle or body is going to move in a direction against the direction of acceleration of gravity. Therefore, the acceleration will become negative. Therefore, a you have to substitute as minus a. Now, with this background, let us see some of the problems which uses the equation of motion to solve the rectilinear problems with uniform acceleration. So, the first problem, we have a car starting from rest and it is accelerated at the rate of 0.4 meter per second square. Find the distance covered by the car in 20 seconds. So you have to find out the distance traveled by the car in 20 seconds. So for that, the data given is it is starting from rest. Therefore, u will be equal to 0. And it is accelerated at the rate of 0.4 meter per second square. Therefore, acceleration is given, which is 0.4 meter per second square. So we know the distance, the equation is s is equal to ut plus half at square. So in this equation, yes, you have to find out. So u is the initial velocity that is given as 0 and the acceleration is given and the time is given. So you have to substitute all the values to get the distance traveled by the car. So here you substitute all the values, you get s is equal to 80 meters. So it's a very simple problem which utilizes the equation of motion to solve the problem. And the second problem also is a very simple problem which is going to use the same equation as the first problem. So here the problem is a train traveling at 27 km per hour is accelerated at the rate of 0.5 meter per second square. What is the distance traveled by the train in 12 seconds? Here also we have to calculate the distance traveled by this train. But here the initial velocity is not zero because it's traveling at 27 kilometer per hour, and it is accelerated at the rate of 0.5 meter per second square. Therefore, the initial velocity given here is 27 kilometer per hour, and you have to convert that initial velocity to meter per second. So if you convert kilometer per hour to meter per second, so you get 27 kilometer per hour as 7.5 meter per second. So you have to substitute here initial velocity 7.5 meter per second, and the acceleration is given 0.5 meter per second square, and the time is given 12 seconds. So with the help of this data, you have to apply s is equal to ut plus half at square in order to calculate the distance traveled by the train. So you get s is equal to 126 meters. And let us see the problem number 3. So here a scooter starts from rest and moves with a constant acceleration of 1.2 meter per second square, determines velocity after it has traveled for 60 meters. That means that you have to calculate the final velocity, and the initial velocity is given as 0 because here in the system it is given that it starts from rest. Therefore, u will become 0. The acceleration is given as 1.2 meter per second square. So you have to calculate the final velocity v, and here the distance is given 60 meters. So for this particular distance, you have to calculate the velocity. So we know this equation, that is v square is equal to u square plus 2as. In that, you have to substitute 0, and the acceleration is given as 1.2 meter per second square. So after substituting all the values, we get the velocity, final velocity as 43.2 kilometer per hour. Now the next problem is a motor car takes 10 seconds to cover 30 meters and 12 seconds to cover 42 meters. Find the uniform acceleration of the car and its velocity at the end of 15 seconds. Now here the two conditions are given. So the first condition is the motor car takes 10 seconds to cover 30 meters, and the second condition is it takes 12 seconds to cover 42 meters. So for these two conditions, you have to get the uniform acceleration of the car and its velocity at the end of 15 seconds. Now let us take the initial velocity of the car is u, and the acceleration is nothing but a. So we know the distance equation, that is s is equal to ut plus half at square. Now you substitute the first condition. So the time given here is 10 seconds and the distance traveled is 30 meter. So after substituting these two the values, you get an equation like this. Similarly, you substitute the second condition, that is in 12 seconds it covers 42 meters. So in the same distance equation, that is s is equal to ut plus half at square, you substitute these two values, that is time 12 seconds and the distance is 42 meters. So you get another equation like this. Now when you simplify these two equations, that is equation 1 and equation 2, so we get the acceleration as 0.5 meter per second square. So in addition to the acceleration, you have to calculate the velocity at the end of 15 seconds. Now the value of acceleration is known. Now you can substitute the value of acceleration in equation 1, so in order to get the initial velocity u. So after getting the initial velocity, you can get the final velocity by making use of this equation, that is v is equal to u plus at. So the initial velocity is known, acceleration is known. So we can substitute all those values in order to get the final velocity. So we get final velocity as 8 meter per second. Now coming to the next problem. So this is you have two electric trains A and B. So they leave the same station on parallel lines. The train A starts from rest with a uniform acceleration of 0.2 meter per second square and attains a speed of 45 kilometer per hour, which is maintained constant afterwards. The train B leaves 1 minute after with a uniform acceleration of 0.4 meter per second square to attain a maximum speed of 72 kilometer per hour, which is maintained constant afterwards. When will the train B overtake the train A? So this is the question. So you have two trains and they are leaving the same station on parallel lines, but the train A starts from rest with certain acceleration, and after that it attains a speed of 45 kilometer per hour, and after attaining the speed will be maintained constant. And the train B, it leaves 1 minute, that is 60 seconds later than the train A in the same station. And here the acceleration of the train B is given as 0.4 meter per second square. So it attains a maximum speed of 72 km/h. After that, it is maintaining that particular speed. Now under these conditions, you have to find at what time the train B will overtake the train A. So this is the question. Now we have to understand the data given in the problem very clearly. So both the trains are starting from rest. Therefore, the initial velocity of the train A, that is UA, is equal to 0. Similarly, the initial velocity of the train B, UB, is also equal to 0. Then acceleration of the train A is given, that is AA, which is 0.2 m/s². So similarly, the final velocity of the train is given, that is 45 km/h. So after attaining this particular velocity, it is going to travel in the same speed. Therefore, this is the final velocity, so which is 45 km/h. If you convert that to m/s, you will be getting 12.5 m/s. And similarly, the acceleration of the train B is given, which is 0.4 m/s². And also the velocity of the train B is given, which is 72 km/h. So which will be maintained in the same speed after that. So if you convert this 72 km/h to m/s, you'll be getting 20 m/s. Now the question is, so you have to find out the time at which the train B overtakes the train A. Now let that particular time be equal to T. So we are taking the capital T as time in seconds when the train B will overtake the train A from its start. Now since each of the trains we know the acceleration and the velocity, so we can calculate the time taken by each of the trains to attain that particular speed. For example, let TA be the time taken by the train A to attain a speed of 12.5 m/s. Now we are going to calculate this particular time TA, which is the time taken by the train A to attain a speed of 12.5 m/s. So for that, we are going to make use of this equation, that is V is equal to U plus AT. So since for train A, initial velocity is 0, so UA is equal to 0. And the final velocity is given, that is 12.5 m/s. And the acceleration is given, that is 0.2 m/s². After substituting all the values in this equation, V is equal to U plus AT, so we get the time which is taken by the train A to attain a speed of 12.5 m/s. So we got TA is equal to 62.5 seconds. Now after getting this particular time, in order that the train A reaches the velocity of 12.5 m/s, so we have to get the distance traveled by the train A to attain this particular speed. So now we know the distance equation also, S is equal to ut plus half at square. So since the initial velocity is 0, u is 0, therefore this term will go away. Then so simply you have S is equal to half ata square. So the acceleration of the train A is given. So time we have found out, that is 62.5 seconds. So which is nothing but the time taken by the train A to attain a speed of 12.5 m/s. So we have now we are calculating the distance traveled by the train A to attain this speed. So the distance we have calculated as 390.6 meters. Therefore, the train A it has traveled a distance of 390.6 meters at 62.5 seconds. So similarly for the train B also, so we can calculate these values. That is, we can calculate the time taken by the train B to attain a speed of 20 m/s. So here the final velocity is 20, initial velocity is again 0. So again we make use of the equation V is equal to U plus AT for train B, and we are calculating the time taken by the train B in order to reach the velocity of 20 m/s. So we got the time as 50 seconds. And similarly, similar to train A, so for train B also, we are going to calculate the total distance traveled by the train B in order to attain this speed of 20 m/s. So we use the equation S is equal to UT plus half AT square. So here also, since the train B starts from rest, UB will be equal to 0. Therefore, this term will become 0. And the acceleration of the train B is known and time is known. So this time is nothing but, again, once again, I'm repeating, it is a time taken by the train B in order to attain a speed of 20 m/s. So we got the distance traveled by the train B as 500 meters. Now in this problem, our task is to find the time capital T, which is nothing but the time at which the train B overtakes the train A. So now the condition is we have to get the time T at which the train B overtakes the train A. So at the time of overtaking, so both the trains must have traveled the same distance. So we are going to apply that concept in order to find the total time T. So first we have to get the total distance traveled by train A as well as the total distance traveled by the train B. Because at the time of overtaking, both the trains must have traveled the same distance. Therefore, first let us calculate the total distance traveled by the train A. So which is equal to the distance traveled by the train A at you have a 62.5 seconds. So this 62.5 where we have seen in the previous slide, it is nothing but the time taken by the train A to attain a speed of 12.5 meter per second. So at that particular time, it has traveled a distance of 390.6 meters. But since the train A has started 60 seconds before the train B, the total time which is traveled by the train A is equal to T plus 60. So already we have calculated the distance for 62.5 seconds. Now the total distance traveled by the train A will be T plus 60 seconds. Therefore, for the remaining distance, for the remaining time, so you have to calculate the distance traveled by the train. So that can be found out using this equation. So this is the distance traveled by the train at 62.5 seconds, whereas the total distance or total time traveled by the train A is T plus 60 seconds. Therefore, we have to find out the distance traveled by the train A for the remaining time. So that remaining time is T plus 60 minus 62.5. So that multiplied by the velocity or the speed of the train A, that is 12.5 meter per second, will give the remaining distance traveled by the train A. So if you add to this particular distance, we'll get the total distance traveled by the train A. So in a similar way, you have to find out the total distance traveled by the train B. So this 500 is nothing but the distance traveled by the train B or a time duration of 50 seconds. So this 50 seconds is nothing but the time at which the train B reaches a speed of 20 meter per second. So now the total, this T is nothing but the time at which the train B overtakes the train A. Therefore, for the remaining distance, you have to calculate the distance. So the time is T minus 50. So that T minus 50 into the speed will give the remaining distance. So the total distance traveled by the train B will be equal to 500 plus velocity into the time, that is T minus 50. So this is the total distance traveled by train A and this is the total distance traveled by train B. So at the time of overtaking, both these distances will be equal. Therefore, we are going to equate these two equations, that is 1 and 2, in order to get the time at which the train B overtakes train A. So far we have seen the problems on rectilinear motion of particles. So where the particles traveled in the horizontal direction. Now we have the next case where we have the motion of a particle under gravity. So this is a special case of rectilinear motion under again constant acceleration. So again these are the examples where a body falling vertically downwards. So here when a body is falling vertically downwards, it is going to travel in a direction which is similar to the direction of acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, here the acceleration due to gravity g is taken as positive or the velocity is taken as positive. So if your body is falling vertically downwards, the direction of the motion will be same as that of the direction of acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, g is positive or velocity we have to take it as positive. On the other hand, suppose if a body is thrown into the air vertically upwards, in that case the body is going to move upwards, whereas the acceleration due to gravity is going to act in the downward direction. So when the direction of the motion of the body is opposite to the direction of acceleration due to gravity, in that case the acceleration g is negative or the velocity is considered as negative. Now in the case of motion of a particle under gravity, we are going to replace the acceleration, that is A, by the acceleration due to gravity, G. So in all the equations of motion, we are going to replace acceleration A by acceleration due to gravity, G. And also the distance we are going to replace, that is S is going to replace by H, because S is used to indicate the horizontal distance traveled by a particle, whereas H is used to indicate the distance traveled by a particle in the vertical direction. Now let us see the equations of motion for the motion of a particle under gravity. So you have two cases as we discussed earlier. So you have a body which is falling freely from a height, and the second case is when you have a body which is projected vertically upwards. So when a body is falling from a height, so these are the equations of motion. So it is similar to the previous equation of rectilinear motion, but here we have v is equal to u plus gt. So previously we have v is equal to u plus at. So simply we have replaced a by g. So the second equation also you have s is equal to ut plus half at square previously, but here half gt square. Similarly v square is equal to u square plus 2gs. So instead of a, we have replaced here by g. So in the case of a body which is falling downwards, or when a body is traveling downwards, so in that case the direction of the motion will be same as the direction of acceleration due to gravity, therefore the velocity will be positive. So here you have to take it as positive. On the other hand, if the body is projected vertically upwards, the direction of the motion of the body will be opposite to the direction of acceleration due to gravity, therefore here the velocity is taken as negative. Therefore in the previous equations you have to substitute u as minus u. Therefore we get v is equal to minus u plus gt, s is equal to minus ut plus half gt square, and v square is equal to minus u square plus 2gs. So these are the equations of motion for a body which is projected vertically upwards. Now in the case of the particles which are traveling under gravity, so you can calculate the maximum height attained by a body. Suppose if a body is thrown vertically upwards, now it will reach to a maximum point, and after that it will reach the, after reaching a particular point, it will reach again back to the ground. So we can calculate the maximum height attained by the body, so using this equation. So since the body is thrown upwards, the velocity will be negative. Therefore, v square is equal to minus u square plus 2gh. So here we are replacing a by g and also s by h. So when a body reaches the maximum height, the final velocity will be equal to zero. So this is the condition. So when a body reaches the maximum height, the final velocity will be zero. Therefore, here we are substituting v is equal to zero. And when v is equal to zero, h will be h maximum, that is maximum height. So at h is equal to h maximum, v is equal to 0. When you substitute these equations, we get h maximum is equal to u square by 2g. Similarly, we can calculate the time taken to reach the maximum height. So when you throw a body upwards, vertically upwards, so we can calculate the time taken by the body to reach the maximum height. Again, from this equation, v is equal to minus u plus gt. So here again, u is negative because the body is traveling upwards, so the velocity will become negative. So minus u plus gt. So at the maximum height, that is at h is equal to h max, again the final velocity will be equal to 0. Therefore, left hand side will become 0. From this, we can calculate the small t, that is the time taken to reach the maximum height, as u by g. So similarly, after reaching the maximum height, the particle or body will come to the surface again. Therefore, the total time taken by the body to reach the maximum height as well as to reach the ground surface can be calculated by multiplying this value by 2, u by g plus u by g. Therefore, the total time taken by the body to reach the maximum height as well as to return to the ground is 2u by g. And similarly, we can calculate the final velocity. Suppose if a body is dropping downwards, or if a body falls from a certain height h, we can calculate the final velocity. So when a body is dropped from a particular height, the initial velocity will be 0. So initial velocity is zero. Therefore, in the equation v square is equal to u square plus 2gh, you have to substitute u is equal to zero. Now, if you note down this equation, so here u is not taken negative, it is taken only positive, because this is the case of a body which is falling downwards. So if a body is falling downwards, the direction of the motion of the body will be same as the direction of the acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, g is positive, therefore the velocity is also going to be positive, therefore here u will be positive. So when it is dropped from a certain height, when it reaches the ground, the velocity will be maximum, whereas when it is dropped from a particular height, the initial velocity will be zero. Therefore, if when you substitute u is equal to zero, we get the final velocity as root of 2gh. Now with this background, let us see some of the problems on motion of a particle under gravity. So the first problem, simple problem, is a stone is thrown upwards with a velocity of 4.9 meter per second from a bridge. If it falls down in water after 2 seconds, then find the height of the bridge. So this is the question. So a stone is thrown upwards. So the velocity at which the stone is thrown is 4.9 meter per second. Therefore, the initial velocity is given, that is 4.9 meter per second. So if it falls down in water after 2 seconds, so the time is given, t is equal to 2 seconds. So you have to find the height of the bridge. So you know the distance equation. Now s is equal to ut plus half at square. But here s is replaced by h and a is replaced by g. Now you see the direction of the motion of the body. Here the stone is thrown upwards. Therefore, the direction of the movement of the stone is against the direction of acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, the velocity should be taken as negative. Therefore, this u, you have to substitute it as minus 4.9. So you have h is equal to ut plus half gt square. U, you have to substitute minus 4.9. So after substituting all the values, we get the height of the bridges, 9.8 meter. So this is a very simple problem. And let us see the second problem on motion of a particle under gravity. So you have a packet which is dropped from a balloon which is going upwards with a velocity of 12 meter per second. Calculate the velocity of the packet after 2 seconds. So here it's a very interesting problem. So we are dropping a packet from a balloon, but that balloon is going upwards. So you please understand the question very carefully. So that balloon is going upwards, whereas a packet is dropped from a balloon with a velocity of 12 meter per second. So since the balloon is moving upwards, the velocity of the balloon, you have to take it as negative, minus 12 meter per second. So you have to get the velocity of the packet after 2 seconds. So the time given here is 2 seconds. And since the balloon is traveling upwards with a velocity of 12 meter per second, and we are going to drop a packet from the balloon, therefore the initial velocity at which the packet is dropped is minus 12 meter per second, which is nothing but the velocity of the balloon. Therefore, this packet is dropped with the initial velocity of minus 12 meter per second. Now you have to calculate the velocity of the packet after 2 seconds. So you know the final equation for velocity, that is v is equal to u plus gt. So here u is minus 12 and g is 9.8 and time taken is 2. Therefore, you can calculate the velocity of the packet after 2 seconds. So we got v is equal to 7.6 meter per second. Now the next problem is a body is dropped from the top of a tall building. If it takes 2.8 seconds in falling on the ground, find the height of the building. So you have a body which is dropped from a top of a building. If it takes 2.8 seconds in falling on the ground, find the height of the building. So you have to find the height of the building. So you know the equation for the distance, that is s is equal to ut plus half at square. So since the body is dropped from the top of a building, the initial velocity will be equal to zero. Therefore, in this equation, u will be equal to 0. Therefore, this term will vanish. Then half gt square. So here again, half into 9.8 into time is given, that is 2.8 seconds. So after substituting it in the equation, so we get the height of the building as 38.4 meter. So it's a very simple problem which uses the equation S is equal to ut plus half gt square. And the next problem is a stone is dropped from the top of a building which is 65 meter high. With what velocity will it hit the ground? So you have to find out the final velocity here. So since it is dropped from the top of a building, initial velocity will be equal to 0, that is u will be equal to 0. And the height of the building is 65 meters. So with this condition, you have to find the final velocity at which the stone will hit the ground. So initial velocity u is 0, the final velocity is taken as v. So we know the equation v square is equal to u square plus 2gs. So after substituting this simple equation, so we got the final velocity is equal to 35.7 meter per second. And the next problem is a body is thrown vertically upwards with a velocity of 28 meter per second. Find the distance it will cover in 2 seconds. So here the body is thrown vertically upwards. Therefore, the velocity will become negative. That is, the given velocity, you have to take it as minus 28 watt per second. Find the distance it will cover in 2 seconds. So you have to find out the distance. So we know the distance equation, S is equal to ut plus half gt square. And here, since it is thrown upwards with a velocity of 28 meter per second, so your initial velocity, you have to take it as minus 28 into time taken is 2 seconds and half g. So you have to substitute all the values and you have to get the total distance covered by the body in 2 seconds from this equation. Now the next problem is a stone is thrown vertically upwards from the ground with a velocity of 49 meter per second. After 2 seconds, another stone is thrown vertically upwards from the same place. If both the stones strikes the ground at the same time, find the velocity with which the second stone was thrown upwards. So here you have two stones here. The first stone is thrown vertically upwards. So the initial velocity of the first stone is given, which is 49 meter per second. And since it is thrown vertically upwards, you have to take the initial velocity as minus 49 meter per second. And the second stone is thrown after 2 seconds, so from the same place. And it is given that both the stones, they strike the ground at the same time. So under these conditions, you have to find the velocity of the second stone, that is the velocity at which the second stone was thrown vertically upwards. Now let us take the first stone. So here the velocity, that is initial velocity, is minus 49 meter per second. So you have to, when it is thrown vertically upwards, so it will reach the maximum height and you have to first get the time taken by the stone to reach the maximum height. So we know the basic equation, v is equal to u plus at. So since at the maximum height, the final velocity is 0. So this v is 0. Therefore, v is equal to u plus gt. So the final velocity is 0 at the maximum height and u is 49 meter per second. So from this equation, we are getting the time taken by the stone to reach the maximum height. And similarly, the time taken by the stone to reach the ground is also the same 5 seconds. So when it takes 5 seconds to reach the maximum height, it will take another 5 seconds to reach the ground. Therefore, the total time taken by the first stone to reach the maximum height and also to come back to the ground is equal to 5 plus 5, which is 10 seconds, which is called as total time of flight. So which includes the time taken to reach the maximum height and another 5 seconds to come back to the ground. So the total time taken by the stone 1 is equal to 10 seconds. Now let us consider the motion of the second stone. So now here the second stone is thrown 2 seconds after the first stone. Therefore, the total time taken by the second stone to reach the maximum height and also to reach the ground will be 10 minus 2, so which is equal to 8 seconds. So this is the total time. Therefore, the time taken by the second stone to reach the maximum height will be half of this. Therefore, 8 by 2, which is equal to 4 seconds. And we know that when the stone reaches the maximum height, the final velocity will be equal to 0. So for the second stone, the final velocity, that is v, is equal to 0. And the initial velocity we have to find out, plus g into t. So here time t is nothing but 4 seconds, which is nothing but the time taken by the second stone to reach the maximum height. So at the maximum height, the velocity, that is the final velocity, will be equal to 0. So using these conditions, so we get the velocity of the second stone as 39.2 meter per second. So this is the velocity at which the second stone was thrown vertically upwards, so that both the stones will reach the ground at the same time. Now you have another interesting problem. So here we have a stone which is dropped from the top of a tower 50 meter high. That is, the height of the tower given here is 50 meter. So we are dropping a stone from the top of a tower. At the same time, another stone is thrown upwards from the foot of the tower with the velocity of 25 meter per second. So one stone is dropped from the top of the tower, and another stone is thrown vertically upwards from the foot of the same tower with the velocity of 25 meter per second. So you have to find out at what time and at which position the two stones cross each other. So this is a very interesting problem. So one stone is dropped from the top and another stone is projected upwards from the foot of the tower. So we have to see at which time the two stones will cross each other, and also you have to see at which position, at which distance these two stones will cross each other. So you have two questions here. So the height of the tower is given as 50 meter. Now let us consider the motion of the first stone. For the first stone, it is dropped from the top of a tower. So when it is dropped from a particular height, the initial velocity will be 0. Therefore, for the first stone, u will be equal to 0. Now let us take t as the time taken for the stones to cross each other. So this t is nothing but the time taken for the stones to cross each other. Now the distance traveled by the stone can be found out using this equation. That is, s is equal to ut plus half gt square. So for the first stone, the initial velocity is 0. So this term will become 0. Then half into gt square. So we get s is equal to 0.5 gt square. Now let us consider the upward motion of the second stone. So in this case, the initial velocity is given as 25 meter per second. And here we have to take the initial velocity as minus 25 meter per second, because the stone is thrown upwards. Therefore, the stone is moving upwards, which is against the direction of acceleration due to gravity. Therefore, here you have to take the initial velocity as minus 25 meter per second. And the distance traveled will be equal to 50 minus s, because the s is nothing but the distance traveled by the first stone. So the distance traveled by the second stone will be equal to 50 minus s. So we know that a distance traveled is 50 minus s, so which is equal to ut plus half gt square. So here the initial velocity is minus 25, you have to substitute, and 0.5 gt square. So you get two equations. So the equation one is for the first stone. So I'm repeating again. So this is for the first stone, the distance traveled by the first stone. So here, since it is dropped from your height, the initial velocity is 0. Therefore, this term will become 0. Therefore, you get an equation, s is equal to half gt square. So which is equal to 0.5 gt square. In the case of second stone, it is thrown upwards. Therefore, the velocity is negative. Therefore, the initial velocity will be minus 25 per second. And the distance traveled by the second stone is equal to 50 minus s, because the total distance traveled by the two stones, that is, we have to find the time at which the two stones cross each other. and also we have to get the distance at which the two stones cross each other. Therefore, if you add this 50 minus s plus s, or if you add the distance traveled by the first stone and the distance traveled by the second stone, that should be equal to the total height of the tower. Therefore, the distance traveled by the second stone will be 50 minus s. So this is the distance is equal to ut plus half gt square. The initial velocity is minus 25. So here we are substituting minus 25. So we get an equation like this. So you have the first equation, you have the second equation. So after simplifying these two equations, or after solving these two equations, we get time is equal to 2 seconds. So this is the time at which the two stones will cross each other. Now you have to find the distance also, the distance at which the two stones cross each other. So if you substitute t in this particular equation, that is equation 1, we can get the distance s. So s is equal to 19.6 meters. So this is the distance at which the two stones will cross each other. Now this is another problem. You have a body which is falling freely under the action of gravity. So it passes two points 10 meters apart vertically in 0.2 seconds. From what height above the higher point did it start to fall? So the question here is, you have two points A and B, and the distance between the two points is 10 meter. So you have a body which is falling freely from a certain height. So in between the two points A and B, that is, it takes about 0.2 seconds in order to travel a distance of 10 meters. So distance between the point A and B is 10 meters. The body, it takes about 0.2 seconds in order to travel from A to B. So this is the circumstance. And under this circumstance, you have to find the height, that is, from which height above the higher point, that is above A, did it start to fall? Did the object start to fall, or did the body start to fall? So this is the question. Now the clue here is the distance between A and B is 10 meter, and the time taken by the body to travel this 10 meter is 0.2 seconds. So with this clue, we'll start the problem. So let u be the initial velocity at A. So initial velocity at A, let us take it as u. Now the distance traveled is 10 meter. So you know the distance equation, s is equal to ut plus half gt square. So here the body is falling downwards. Therefore, the velocity will be positive. So u is again taken as positive. So time taken is 0.2 seconds plus half into 9.8 into 0.2 square. So distance traveled is 10 meters. Therefore, we can get the initial velocity u is 49 meter per second. Therefore, the velocity of the body at the particular point A is 49 meter per second. So we have to get the distance x, that is about the point A from which the body falls. So for this, you consider this point A. You consider this point A. Now let us consider the motion of the body from point O to point A. So now, since the body is starting from rest, the initial velocity will be 0. And the final velocity will be the velocity at this point. So now we are considering the motion of a body from O to A. So at O, the initial velocity will be 0. And at A, the final velocity will be the velocity what we have got already, which is 49 meter per second. Now this u will become v. That is, it's nothing but the final velocity at point A. U is the initial velocity at the point O. Since the initial velocity at the point O is 0, so here in this equation, v square is equal to u square plus 2gs. We substitute the final velocity as 49 meter per second and the initial velocity as 0. So 2gh or s. So here the distance is x. So we are substituting x. So from this equation, we are getting the value of x as 122.5 meters. But therefore, when a body is dropped at a height of from a height of 122.5 meter from O, so when it reaches the point A, then it takes about 0.2 seconds in order to travel from A to B. Now the next problem is, you have a stone which is dropped into a well, is heard to strike the water after 4 seconds. Find the depth of the well if the velocity of the sound is 350 meter per second. So we are dropping the stone into a well. So we hear the sound of the stone after 4 seconds. So we have to find out the depth of the well if the velocity of the sound is 350 meter per second. So when a stone is dropped into a well, so it will take certain time to reach the bottom of the well. And it also takes some time for the sound to be heard to reach the top. So that time is given, that is 4 seconds. So this 4 second is nothing but the total time taken by the stone to reach the bottom of the well, and also it is the time taken by the sound to reach the top of the well. So that total time is equal to 4 seconds. So now let us first take T as the time taken by the stone to reach the bottom of the well. So we can find out the depth of the well from this equation, that is S is equal to UT plus half GT square. And here since it is dropped into a well, the initial velocity will be equal to 0. So the stone is dropped from a height, so the initial velocity will be equal to 0. Therefore here U will be equal to 0 plus half G T square. So you get the equation as S is equal to 4.9 T square. So this S is nothing but the depth of the well. So S is equal to 4.9 T square. And also we can calculate from the velocity of the sound, you can calculate the time taken by the sound to reach the top. So this can be calculated from this equation, that is time is equal to depth divided by velocity, or the velocity is nothing but distance traveled by time taken. So from this, time taken by the sound to reach the top is equal to depth of the well divided by velocity. So depth, again this is equal to S, divided by the velocity is 350. So already we got S is equal to 4.9 T square. So 4.9 T square divided by 350. So this is the time taken by the sound to reach the top. So this T is the time taken by the stone to reach the bottom of the well. And this is the time taken by the sound to reach the top. So the total time, that is 4 seconds, is nothing but the sum of these two. That is time taken by the stone to reach the bottom of the well, as well as the time taken by the sound to reach the top. Now we are adding these two. That is T plus 4.9 T square divided by 350 is equal to 4. So when you simplify this equation, you get a quadratic equation in T. After solving this quadratic equation in T, we get time is equal to 3.8 seconds. So after getting this value of 3.8 seconds, so this T is nothing but the time taken by the stone to reach the bottom of the well. So now what is the time taken by the sound to reach the top then? So it is equal to 0.2 seconds, because the total time is 4 seconds. So the time taken by the stone to reach the bottom of the well is 3.8 seconds, whereas the time taken by the sound to reach the top will be 4 minus 3.8, which is 0.2 seconds. Now the question is, you have to find the depth of the well. So S is nothing but the depth of the well. We know that S is equal to 4.9 T square. After knowing the value of T, we can substitute the value of T here to get the total depth of the well. So total depth of the well is 70.8 meters. Now we have another interesting problem in the rectilinear motion of particles. So we can calculate the distance traveled by the particle in nth second from certain equation. So for that we are assuming these data, that is U is the initial velocity of the particle in meter per second, and A is the acceleration of the particle in meter per second square, and Sn is the distance traveled in n seconds, and Sn minus 1 is the distance traveled in n minus 1 seconds. So if you know the distance traveled by the body in n seconds and n minus 1 seconds, then you can easily calculate the distance traveled in n second. So the distance traveled in n second is equal to the distance traveled in n seconds minus the distance traveled in n minus 1 seconds, which is equal to Sn minus Sn minus 1. So we know this basic equation of motion, that is the distance equation. S is equal to ut plus half at square. So if you want to calculate the distance traveled in n seconds, so we can write Sn is equal to U. So T, you have to substitute T is equal to N, half A N square. Similarly, if you want to calculate the distance traveled by the body in N minus 1 seconds, so this is N minus 1, N minus 1 seconds. So you get S N minus 1 is equal to U. So for T, you have to substitute N minus 1 plus half A N minus 1 square. So we know that distance traveled in N second is Sn minus Sn minus 1. So when you simplify this, you will get the distance traveled in n second as u plus a by 2 into 2n minus 1. So this is another equation which will be used for solving the problems, especially if you want to calculate the distance traveled by a particle in n second. Now we'll see just one problem based on this. So this is the problem: by what initial velocity a ball should be projected vertically upwards so that the distance covered by it in 5th second is twice the distance covered in its 6th second. So take g as 10 meter per second square. So here you have to find the initial velocity of the ball. So the ball should be projected upwards. So you have to find out at which velocity the ball should be projected upwards. So that you are given two conditions. That is, the condition given here is the distance covered by the ball in 5th second should be equal to twice the distance covered by the ball in 6th second. So you know the basic equation. So, and here, since the ball is traveling upwards, the velocity should be taken negative. Therefore, here in the equation, we get minus u. So half into g into. So here, first we are calculating the distance covered by the ball in 5th second, that is S5. Using this equation. Similarly, we are calculating the distance covered by the ball in 6th second by making use of this equation. So the same equation with u as negative. So here also u, we have taken negative since the ball is projected upwards. Here also u is negative because the ball is projected upwards. And here the time t is equal to 5 seconds. And here the time t, we have taken 6 seconds. And the given condition is the distance traveled in 5th second is twice the distance traveled by the ball in 6th second. So S5 is equal to, you get this equation. Similarly, S6 is equal to, you get this equation. And the distance traveled in 5th second is twice the distance traveled in 6th second. Therefore, your distance S5 should be equal to twice this S6. So minus u plus 45 is equal to 2 into S6. So 2 into minus u plus 55. So when you simplify this equation, we get the initial velocity of the ball as 65 meter per second. So here we make use of the simple equation, that is of finding the distance traveled by a particle in n second. So you have this basic equation, Sn is equal to minus u plus g by 2 into 2n minus 1. So for 5th second, we are writing an equation. Similarly, for 5th second, you are writing an equation. And based on the condition given, so we are substituting. So here the distance covered in 5th second is equal to twice the distance covered in 6th second. Therefore, S5 will be equal to 2 into S6. So after substituting this condition, we get the initial velocity of the ball as 65 meter per second. So far, we have discussed problems of rectilinear motion with constant acceleration. So in all the problems we have seen so far, the acceleration value is given as constant. So the acceleration was not a varying quantity. But now there are some practical problems of rectilinear motion in which the acceleration will be a varying one. So the acceleration will be varying with respect to time. So in order to solve these problems, so we have to again make use of certain equations of motion. So here, since it is a variable acceleration, so the velocity will also vary with respect to time, and acceleration will also vary with respect to time. So we know that the velocity is rate of change of displacement, so which is ds by dt. Similarly, the acceleration is rate of change of velocity, which is dv by dt. Now, we can substitute v is equal to ds by dt here. So when you substitute v is equal to ds by dt, so you get d by dt of ds by dt, which is equal to d square s by dt square. And also we know that acceleration so is dv by dt. So dv And for dt, we can substitute from this equation, we can calculate dt is equal to ds by v. So, or when you bring this to this side, so you get v dv. If you bring this to top, you get a into ds is equal to v into dv. So, these are the two equations. So, we are going to make use of in order to solve the problems of rectilinear motion with variable acceleration. So, we know velocity is ds by dt and acceleration is dv by dt. So, here we are substituting v is equal to ds by dt. Therefore, a we get d square s by dt square. And also from this equation, so we can get dt, which is nothing but ds by v. So, here we are substituting in the acceleration equation dv by dt. So, dt is equal to ds by v. So, when you bring this up to the top, we will get a into ds is equal to v into dv. So, these are the equations of motion in the case of rectilinear motion with variable acceleration. So, here we have some simple problems using equations of motion in order to solve the problems of rectilinear motion with variable acceleration. So, here comes the first problem. A car moves along a straight line whose equation of motion is given by s is equal to 12t plus 3t square minus 2t cube, where s is in meters and t is in seconds. Calculate the velocity and acceleration at start and acceleration when velocity is 0. So, here the distance equation is given. So, s is equal to 12t plus 3t square minus 2t cube. So, when you differentiate this equation for displacement, you will get the velocity. So, ds by dt is equal to, so when you differentiate this, we will be getting 12 plus 6t minus 6t square. So, this is nothing but the velocity. So, ds by dt is nothing but velocity. So, we get v is equal to 12 plus 6t minus 6t square. Now, the question is, you have to find the velocity and acceleration at the start. So, at the start of the motion means at time t equal to 0. So, at start, that is at time t equal to 0, you have to calculate the velocity and acceleration. So, if you substitute t is equal to 0 in this equation, we can get the velocity as 12 meter per second. Similarly, the acceleration is nothing but dv by dt. So, when you differentiate again this equation, you get 6 minus 12t. Again, you have to get the acceleration at the start. Again, you have to substitute t is equal to 0. So, when you are asked to calculate the quantities at the start, you have to substitute t is equal to 0. So, in this problem, you are given the displacement equation. So, velocity is nothing but ds by dt. So, you have to differentiate this equation once. And in order to get the acceleration, you have to find out dv by dt. So, if you are asked to get the velocity and acceleration at the start, you have to substitute t is equal to 0 in both velocity equation as well as acceleration equation to get the velocities and acceleration. And the second question is, you have to find out the acceleration when the velocity is 0. So, here the velocity, so the velocity equation is this, v is equal to 12 plus 6t minus 6t square. So, you have to find out the acceleration when the velocity is 0. So, when you make this as 0, so you get 12 plus 6t minus 6t square is equal to 0. So, you get a quadratic equation. So, after solving this quadratic equation, you can get time t is equal to 2 seconds. So, you can substitute this time t is equal to 2 seconds in the acceleration equation to get the acceleration of the car. So, the acceleration we get 18 meter per second square. Now, coming to the next problem, the motion of a particle is given by a is equal to t cube minus 3t square plus 5, where a is the acceleration in meter per second square. So, in the previous problem, the distance equation was given, but here the acceleration equation is given. So, which is t cube minus 3t square plus 5, where t is the time in seconds. And the velocity of the particle at time t equal to 1 second is 6.25 meter per second, and the displacement is 8.8 meters. Therefore, at time t equal to 1, the velocity is given as 6.25 meter per second and the displacement value is given as 8.8 meters. So, for these conditions, you have to calculate the displacement and velocity at time t equal to 2 seconds. So this is the question. So here you are given the acceleration. So we know a is equal to t cube minus 3t square plus 5. So when you do, we know that acceleration is rate of change of velocity, that is dv by dt. So this is equal to dv by dt, that is acceleration is rate of change of velocity, which is equal to dv by dt. So the given equation can be written as dv by dt is equal to t cube minus 3t square plus 5. Now you have to integrate this equation. So in order to get the velocity, so you have to integrate this equation. So when you integrate this equation with respect to time, so you get t power 4 by 4 minus 3 r cube by 3 plus 5. I'm sorry. So here you have dv by dt is equal to t cube minus 3t square plus 5. So you have to integrate this equation in order to get the velocity. So when you integrate this equation with respect to time, you'll get v is equal to t power 4 by 4 minus 3t cube by 3 plus 5t plus a constant c1. So after integrating this equation with respect to time, so we get velocity is equal to this equation. So this constant, the c1 is nothing but the constant of integration. So in order to get this constant of integration, we have to apply the given condition. So the given condition is at time t equal to 1, the velocity of the particle is 6.25 meter per second. So here the velocity, this is the velocity equation. So you have to substitute t equal to 1 here, and also velocity you have to substitute v equal to 6.25. So after substituting this condition, we get the constant of integration as 2. So after getting the constant of integration, you have to substitute the constant of integration in the velocity equation. Therefore, we get v is equal to t power 4 by 4 minus t cube plus 5t plus 2. Now, the question is, you have to find the velocity and displacement at time t equal to 2 seconds. So first, let us calculate the velocity since we have the velocity equation already. So in this is the velocity equation. So in this equation, you have to substitute time t equal to 2 seconds in order to get the velocity at t equal to 2 seconds. The other question is, you have to calculate the displacement at t is equal to 2 seconds. In order to get the displacement at t equal to 2 seconds, so first you have to integrate this equation again to get the displacement, because we know that v is equal to ds by dt. So we need to get, so we know that v is equal to ds by dt. So in order to get the displacement, you have to again integrate this velocity equation. So ds by dt is equal to this. So when you integrate this, you'll get the distance, when you integrate this, you'll get t power 5 by 5 minus t power 4 by 4 plus 5t square by 2 plus 2t plus another constant c2. So this another constant c2 again can be found out by applying the second condition. That is, the second condition given here is at time t equal to 1, your displacement is 8.8. So we are going to apply this equation, we are going to apply this condition in this equation to get the constant of integration c2. So we get the constant of integration c2 as 4.5. So now we are substituting this constant c2 back in the displacement equation. So we get a displacement equation like this. So now we want to get the displacement at time t equal to 2 seconds. So simply we can substitute t is equal to 2 in this equation to get the displacement at time t equal to 2 seconds. So from this problem, what we can understand is that if you are given an acceleration, so we can get the velocity as well as the distance. So by integrating the equations, that is, we know that acceleration is dv by dt. So if you are given acceleration, the velocity can be found out by integrating the equation of acceleration. Similarly, if you want to get the displacement, you can integrate the equation of velocity to get the distance. So with this, we come to the conclusion, or we come to an end of rectilinear motion of particles. So in this lecture, we have covered rectilinear motion with the uniform acceleration as well as rectilinear motion with variable acceleration. And also we have seen three different cases in rectilinear motion with uniform acceleration. That is when a particular body is moving in the horizontal direction. And the second case when the body is traveling vertically downwards. And the third case is when the body is projected vertically upwards. So for all the three cases, we have seen how the equations of motion have been modified. And we also have seen how to apply the equations of motion to solve the problems of rectilinear motion with both constant acceleration as well as variable acceleration. So for this particular presentation or lecture, I have used these references for the preparation of my lecture. Thank you.